During the Austrian Grand Prix, there were 1, 2, 3 incidents of drivers attempting overtakes around the outside, only to get run wide and find themselves skittering across the gravel. In all three occasions, the defending driver on the inside was punished by the stewards for not leaving enough room for their attacker. Is this fair? And does it represent a racing we want to see? Let's have a look. And speaking of keeping things close at peak performance, this video is sponsored by Manscaped. No matter how you might like to shape, trim, remove, or improve your personal grooming situation, you can do it with confidence and style with Manscaped. They sent me over their performance package kit, which includes the Lawnmower 3.0 with waterproof trimmer and advanced skin-safe technology to protect your skin from any nasty nicks. The Weed Whacker ear and nose hair trimmer to keep things neat and tucked out of sight. The Shears 2.0 luxury nail kit so you don't neglect your fingers or your toes. And Hoomst among us would go without ball deodorant and toner. Hoomst! Go to manscaped.com today and use promo code CHAINBEAR20 for 20% off, free international shipping, and 2 free gifts. Genuinely useful, genuinely super comfortable. Honestly, so soft. Anyway, go use that promo code, your body will be delighted. And now, back to the video. So our three key incidents here are Perez versus Norris at turn 4, Leclerc versus Perez at turn 4, in a very similar incident, and then Leclerc versus Perez again at turn 6. Let's start with Norris and Perez. Norris was leading Perez at the safety car restart, but heading downhill towards turn 4, Perez managed to get a good run on Norris, pulling alongside and to the left as they enter the braking zone. Norris deliberately places his car on the inside line heading into turn 4 to force Perez to go the long way around. Had Perez been able to tuck inside, it would have been a much easier pass. For Norris, this is him taking the high ground in defence. Perez is actually momentarily ahead at the turning point of the corner, but the outside line is the weaker of the two. Due to the slope of the geography, turn 4 is a bit off camber, meaning the track slopes away to the outside, inducing understeer into the car and coaxing it out wider than you'd want. Lando holds position on the inside, and to be fair, Sergio remains quite significantly alongside as they both navigate the corner. Norris's natural racing line when putting his foot down is to allow the car the full width of the track on exit, and as he reaches the outside curb, Perez is still hanging in there and has nowhere left to go but off track. Now Norris doesn't actually touch Perez, but Perez keeps out of contact by drifting across the concrete and gravel, losing positions in the process. Should Norris have allowed room for Perez? Some suggesting the International Sporting Code mandates leaving a full car's width to your rival when moving across the track, but this isn't strictly true. If we look at the International Sporting Code, Appendix L, Chapter 4, which details the code of conduct on racing circuits, it states, any driver moving back towards the racing line, having defended their position offline, should leave at least one car width between their own car and the edge of the track on the approach to the corner. This is about drivers who defend into a corner and then move back across to take a sensible racing line into the corner, not about claiming the line through the exit of the corner. Norris says he was entitled to complete the racing line through the corner as Sergio hadn't overtaken him and that Sergio knew the risks of going around the outside. Now this last part is key in particular. If you're going to throw a move around the outside, you know there are risks involved of being muscled out of room and coming off worse. This is a fact echoed by most pundits who assess the situation, including Christian Horner himself, who called it a racing incident even before Perez went on to do very similar things in defence later in the race. It's also worth noting that at this part of the battle, the only way for Norris to give room to Perez is to give up the corner completely. The car, at the speed it's travelling, will naturally drift outwards. To leave room on the outside, Norris would have to significantly slow down to tuck into a tighter line, which would have just given up the position, most likely. And the precedent there is saying that in order to overtake, you just need to be alongside going into the corner, which feels wrong. Nonetheless, the stewards deemed Norris to be in the wrong, that he forced another driver off the track and gave him a 5-second penalty and 2 penalty points. Kind of harsh. Let's fast forward to lap 41, where this time Perez is on the defence into the same corner, and Leclerc is going for a move around the outside. Now there are some slight differences here. Most notably, they do touch, and secondly, Leclerc is slightly ahead of Perez through the corner. Not a lot, but in a way that Perez wasn't when making the move earlier on Norris. If you watch the steering wheels through the corner, Perez is making every effort to steer through the corner, but it's an understeery corner and he was always going to drift wide. He bumps Leclerc very slightly mid-corner and continues his path across the full width of the track in the same way that Norris did. Leclerc actually backs out once he's touching the gravel, so he's able to tuck back into the track more quickly than Perez did when he was pushed wide. But again, Leclerc should have known the risks around the outside, but went for it anyway. Should Perez have to pay the penalty for that? Well, the stewards thought so. They gave him exactly the same penalty as Norris. If we wind back to this point of the corner, we can ask, what are Leclerc's options at this point? Either he's going to completely overtake Perez in a clean sweep around the outside, or he doesn't. And if he doesn't think he's fully going to make the move, then holding on around the outside is a big risk. He must know Perez is going to drift out towards him. His other option is to hold a wide line into turn four and sling the car in for a better run-up through the next sequence, countering the slower speed Perez has had to take holding the inside. And this is what he does 6 laps later. Leclerc's wide entry into turn four allowed him to straighten up a little bit earlier, giving him great acceleration, pulling alongside Perez on the inside of turn five. The cars are side by side into turn six, but now Leclerc is back on the outside again, but attempts to hold position against Perez. They are super close, side by side as they exit the corner, and honestly, might both have made it through. Perez is well aware of Leclerc's presence, and from his steering angle, looks to be giving him just enough space. Now, unfortunately, as he heaves on some acceleration, the car twitches with oversteer, sending it drifting out slightly and squeezing Leclerc off track once again. So you could kind of give Perez a bit of blame here as he lost control of the car and Leclerc suffered for it. The stewards once again gave Perez a 5-second penalty and another 2 points on his license. 4 penalty points in one race for some marginal calls there that some might say were all racing incidents. So in all these incidents, we can ask, did the attacking driver claim the position? Did they win the corner? I think we can agree that they had not at any point beaten their opponent and made the overtake. The corner was still in contention. Okay, but had they won the right to have more space given them? And that seems to be the contentious issue. I mean, I'm glad the stewards were consistent at least. You know, after their call on Norris, they had to hand out the same penalties to Perez and Perez again. They were all functionally similar. But do we agree with the call in general? Will Buxton recounts Derek Warwick's take on the situations. Now, Warwick was one of the driver stewards making the calls during the race weekend. There are a few main points here, the main one being that if an attacking car is substantially alongside, then racing room has to be given. And I think there's some argument in that, to be honest, though I think Buxton gives 2 flawed analogies in his reasoning. He first imagines a scenario on a straight in which a defending car edges an attacking car off the track. He also suggests a scenario in which the attacking car is on the inside instead of the outside of the corner, and the defending car closes the door on them. Both situations are slam dunk penalties, he says. And yes, this is true. But the key difference here is that in both of these scenarios, that natural forces acting on the car are not pulling it in these directions needed to boff the other car off the track. On the straight, the car will continue to travel straight unless a driver tells it to do otherwise. The driver needs to tell the car to close the door on an attacker on the straight. And if the attacking car is alongside, then yeah, that's a penalty. Through a corner, the natural inclination of the car is to not go through the corner. It will drive wide unless you force it to do otherwise. Turning into a car, attacking through the inside of a corner, is again a conscious choice on the part of the defending driver. And as the inclination of a car is to drift wide through a corner, that is why attacking around the outside is this big risk, because you're sticking your foot in a naturally closing door. So the argument becomes, should a defending driver give up their speed and position if an attacker is able to pull up along the outside? And part of me thinks, yes? Here's the thing. In order to overtake through a corner, you need to compromise the car you're attacking. By placing yourself alongside your opponent, you've kind of successfully said, this part of the track is mine now. If you want to complete the corner, you now have to take a compromised line, which is kind of fair. I don't think you should be run off the road for that. I think your opponent has to react to this attack by working in the space they've been left with once you force them in a tighter area by being fast enough to pull alongside. So I think the actual penalties given were harsh, particularly the penalty points given. But there is definitely a lot to be said about leaving your rival room if they actually are significantly alongside you. You know, even if Will Buxton's analogies were bad in this instance and people are misreading the international sporting code. In all 3 cases, the defending driver was in the wrong. But how much in the wrong. I don't think this wrong, but, you know, maybe just the 5-second penalty of wrongitude. What do you think?